All right, so hello and welcome. Thank you for logging on to this evening's program. My name is Matt Schumann. I am a programming librarian here at Cary Library. Before we begin, I just want to make a short dedication to George Burnell. George passed away on November 3rd. I had the pleasure of working on the library's programming team and with George over the past 3 years. This economics and science series was a passion project of George's, bringing to the library many notable Lexington residents in these fields. I was always awed by George's networking, how one man could know so many important people from Gary Gensler, Peter Diamond, Kathryn Flanagan, Alan Sinai, and more. And beyond the recognizable names, the hundreds of people who would always come to his programs, filling the living room at the library or Zoom webinars during the pandemic. And he impressed me by being outgoing with this project and enthusiastic about it. And I appreciated also his sense of humor. I spoke to him a couple of weeks before he died. And I remember him ending the phone call with a series of self-deprecating jokes that I couldn't help but laugh at because he was laughing hysterically at them. But George was inspirational to work with because he was so dedicated to his passions. And I always looked forward to the next fascinating speaker he would bring to this series. And I will miss working with him. Just stopping my share real quick. Okay. Now, please let me know if there are any technical issues. I can try to resolve them. And please send your questions via the Q&A button and we will address them at the end. I'd like to now introduce Dr. Kathryn Flanagan. She holds an astronomer emerita appointment at the Space Telescope Science Institute, where she has served as the James Webb Space Telescope mission head, deputy director, and interim director. The Institute is responsible for the science operations of the Hubble Space Telescope, as well as the mission and science operations of its successor, the James Webb Space Telescope. Dr. Flanagan came to the Institute in 2007 to head the mission office for the James Webb Space Telescope with responsibility for developing the James Webb Space Telescope Science and Operations Center. In her early career, she earned a PhD in physics at MIT, where she began working in the field of X-ray astronomy, with special interest in developing new instruments for space. She became part of the research staff at the Smithsonian Astrophysical Observatory and MIT, and she has worked on multiple flight instruments. She has participated in NASA's advisory structure, co-chairing strategic planning documents and serving on advisory committees. She has been active in astronomical community organizations and was recently honored by election as a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. She has been active in education, beginning with service as a Peace Corps volunteer teaching math and physics in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and is a strong advocate for science outreach to the public and the next generation. Now, please welcome Dr. Kathryn Flanagan.
Thank you, Matthew. I hope you can all see this. I would like to say first that I found George Burnell to be intelligent, interesting, optimistic, and a force for good. And when I met him 2 years ago, he also opened up to me the idea that I could be a welcome part of Lexington. So I'm very pleased to give this talk in his honor. The image you see in front of you with the purple and the little filamentary structures, it's called the Veil Nebula. Obviously, veil comes from the amorphous shape and the lovely filamentary structure. This is actually the remnant of an explosion of a star 8,000 years ago. So our early ancestors at that time must have looked on in wonder and wondered about this. And you can imagine that they were thinking, these are pretty interesting times. That was a good millennium, actually. They cultivated barley, from which you can make beer. They domesticated cats, which many of us have as pets. They developed proto-writing, not a bad advancement, but we have a pretty good millennium, in fact, a pretty good century already. 6 short years ago, we discovered gravitational waves. And to be honest with you, in 1 month, we will launch the James Webb Space Telescope, which I want to tell you about. I think it will be revolutionary for astronomy. So let's get to it. Let's see what it's about.
Kathryn, do you mind if I interrupt you for just 1 second? Do you mind resharing your screen? There just seems to be these like black boxes that are covering over it. And I think sometimes that's Zoom just glitching.
Okay. I'm going to stop and then start again.
Yes.
All right.
Yep. I think that hopefully will fix it. Sorry to interrupt.
That's all right. But actually, I can't find my, oh, here it is. My cursor is missing. I'll have to get out of it. Here we go. Stop sharing. And now let's try it again. I hope it's not a bandwidth issue.
No, it's just.
Can people see?
You go ahead and press play. It should be. They're still there, but I guess they're small enough that it's probably not an issue.
Okay. All right. Feel free to stop me if we need to try something.
Are there just any like windows that you see covering over your presentation, or is it just you? Okay, yeah, I would just go forward then. Sorry.
That's okay. So, a little introduction to James Webb. The Webb Telescope is actually an international collaboration of 3 of my favorite space agencies: NASA, the European Space Agency, and the Canadian Space Agency. Goddard Space Flight Center is the managing entity. Northrop Grumman is our largest industrial partner in the United States. And my institution, Space Telescope, also known as STSCI, is the location and the force that does the science operations and the mission operations both in Baltimore. I need to describe it a little briefly to you. This is a deployable telescope, an infrared telescope. Deployable because it is so large, it had to be segmented and folded up in order to fit into a launch vehicle. And therefore, in space, it will be opened up and expanded and focused in space before it can operate. It's also, the size of the telescope is so large that ESA's Ariane 5 rocket was needed in order to be able to accommodate it. As we will see, as we design it together, we will figure out what kind of design is required to do the science. We will see that we have to place this telescope about 1 million miles away to be able to do its job. And the Ariane 5 rocket is just the thing we need for that. There are 4 science instruments, which I list here. NIRCam, which is an infrared camera. NIRSpec, I love NIRSpec. It's a spectrograph, which we will show, you will see a little bit later on how this particular one works. The mid-infrared instrument, MIRI, which is a European consortium contributed instrument, and NIRIS from the Canadian Space Agency and ComDev. My point here is that this is a collaboration among not only different space agencies, but also industry, academia, and space telescopes. So a lot of different entities have come together to make this work. There are 4 science themes that drive the design. And I'm going to discuss them basically as 2 groups. And we will see why it has to be designed in the iconic form that James Webb has. The first 2 images you see at the top pertain to the ability of James Webb to look at light that is redshifted. Redshifted light is light from very distant objects at the edge of the universe. We will come to discuss why that is. So in order to see very distant objects, which are also objects that have sent us light emitted billions of years ago, we need to look at redshifted light. On the bottom is the area that pertains to dusty environments. The birth of planets and stars is a very dusty, murky environment. And as we will find out, infrared is also good for peering through these environments. Now, there are there's a lot of scope in these four designs. If you look at the upper left, we start with first light. First light means the light from the very first galaxies as they were formed and able to transmit their light. So that's the very first galaxies right after the Big Bang. We're talking Big Bang time or shortly thereafter. And at the bottom, we look at exoplanet characterization. Exoplanet is a planet around some other star that's not our sun. So if we're looking at planets around other stars, planets maybe that are habitable, we might be talking about a scope that starts with the Big Bang and ends with life. And I kind of like that idea. And as a theme song, I'm thinking of the Big Bang Theory. I looked up their theme song to see if it's appropriate. Our whole universe was in a hot, dense state. And then it comes up with the line, math, science, history, unraveling the mysteries that all started with the Big Bang. Yes, we have a theme song. Big Bang, the civilization, we're there. But we got to start with this first one, the first light. Let's see if we can design an observatory that's going to see the first galaxies ever to have formed. All right, I have to talk about light briefly. This is a spectrum. Light is just electromagnetic waves. And our eyes are able to detect visible light, which you see there, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. The red is on the right, the blue is on the left. All the high energies are toward the left in this picture. The lower energies are toward the right. We have space observatories that see other wavelengths than visible. Hubble sees visible and sees infrared and it sees ultraviolet. James Webb Space Telescope is going to be infrared. Spitzer Space Telescope, longer infrared. Not shown here is the Chandra X-ray Observatory, which observes in the X-ray, and it's operated locally, right in Cambridge. Now, I'm interested in this for a couple of reasons. Let's think for a second. Our eyes only see visible light, but did you know that snakes can see in the infrared? And they can see in the infrared because when they're hanging out in the desert, little mice that run by radiate in the infrared. So it's handy for them to be able to detect infrared light. Warm objects like mice, and as you see, puppies, emit infrared. This will become important to us. Okay. We're ready to design our telescope. We're going to make an instrument that's going to see the first galaxies. That's our science criterion. What do we have to do? Well, we have to figure out what a galaxy looks like. There's a galaxy, pretty nice looking galaxy, shines invisible light. How do I know this? If I'm up in Maine someday, I might be able to look at the dark sky and see, you know, the Milky Way, the little faint light from the Milky Way. So I know it's got visible light. Okay, first thing, I'm probably gonna need maybe a visible light instrument. And I wanna see the first galaxies after the Big Bang. And that means I have to see light that was emitted 13 billion years ago. Why do I know that? Because the Big Bang Theory song tells me it was 13 billion years ago. Okay, good. So it's very distant. I'm gonna have to look at galaxies that are emitting light way far away. And therefore they're gonna be faint. So I'm gonna need a big mirror to capture a lot of light. So I got big mirror. Okay, we're well on our way to a design. Anything else I need to worry about? Well, actually, yes. I want you to look at this and I wanna remind you that if a galaxy is at the far edge of the universe, it emits its light, invisible or ultraviolet, but the universe was expanding. And after 13.7 billion years, by the time it gets to Earth, it's actually been stretched out or redshifted. Redshifted. That means it's no longer visible light. It has moved over in the spectrum and it's now infrared light. Okay. All right, so I'm going to mend my design a little bit. I need a big mirror, I need infrared sensitivity. We're good here. Anything else I need to be able to see those first galaxies? There's one little funny thing. What was that thing? Well, remember those mice in the desert? What about my pet ginger sitting here those mice and those puppies radiate in the infrared because they're warm. And although I like my dog and everything, it seems to me that that's going to be a little bit of an impediment if I'm looking for this really faint object in the infrared. I don't want any other infrared light bothering me. So I'm probably going to have some sort of parasol or a sunshield. All right, design criteria. Number one, I need a big mirror. Number two, it needs to be infrared. Number three, I need to shield it from the light. And I just want you to know, I checked the Earth and I checked Wikipedia, the fountain of all wisdom and knowledge, and I discovered that the average temperature of the Earth is, wait for it, room temperature. Room temperature peaks right in the infrared. So it's a great planet, but it is kind of a problem for our observatory because it's going to be a contaminating source of infrared light. So I need to have my sunshield protect the optic or the mirror from the light from the Earth and, you know, the light from the sun and the light from the moon. So I need a big sunshield, and I need to guarantee it's always got the sun and the Earth and the moon lined up well behind it. So how do I do that? Well, it turns out that there is a location called the second Lagrange point, fancy way for, we call it L2, that if you line up the sun, the Earth, and a satellite farther away, three times farther away than the moon, then the centrifugal force on the satellite just balances the gravitational attraction of the sun and the Earth, and they all stay lined up. So as the Earth rotates around the sun, the satellite rotates right along with it, which is very convenient for us because then I can guarantee that the sunshield will actually block all that unwanted light. So four design criteria: big mirror, infrared, sunshield, and we have to place it at this point, L2. Let's take a quick look at what that looks like.
The James Webb Space Telescope orbits the sun in sync with Earth, but 1 million miles further out beyond the moon. The telescope's mirror is perpendicular to the 70-foot sunshield, which keeps it cool.
Okay, so with this clip, we see that the mirror that we've designed, which is big and infrared and all that stuff, is on the cold side, and all that contaminating infrared radiation from the Earth and from the pets and the mice is on the other side. So we now have a design that works. 10 minutes invested. All we need is a few billion bucks and a bunch of years, and we're good to go. We got ourselves a James Webb. The only problem is it's so big, it wouldn't fit in a traditional rocket. So we actually had to segment the mirrors, as shown here, fold them up, fold the sunshield up, stuff it into a rocket, and we need a big rocket. So a big telescope needs a big rocket, and it's the Ariane 5. And as you can see, it's going to launch from French Guiana, which is close to the equator. We're good to go. We have our design. Let's take a look at what it actually looks like in deployment. So we see the solar array coming down. What I want to point out is this is James Webb unfolding. There's the antenna. In the lower left, you see where it is in its orbit. It's now passing the Earth and starting to go, it's off the Earth, it's passing the moon, as you see on the lower left. The sunshield is coming down. The central boom is coming up with the primary mirror on it. They're now about to tension the sunshield. And it's still on its way to L2. Five layers of sunshield all separated. Now this trim tabs come out for momentum management. We see the secondary mirror deploy. And now we will see the rest of the primary mirror, the wings, as I call it, come out and lock in place. And now the observatory has finally made it out to L2. And all of that takes close to a month. And we will see more about that later. So we did talk about redshift. I do want to talk about thermal imaging. This guy's hand is hidden behind this object. Visible light can't penetrate. I can't see how many fingers he's holding up. But if I look at it with an infrared camera, it becomes clear to me. What this tells me is that with infrared light, I am able to see what's going on in a murky, dusty, opaque environment. So infrared light is really going to help us look in those dusty environments where stars form and where planets form, planets perhaps like Earth. That's going to be great. And let's take a look at a situation here. I just want you to look at this particular astronomical object. You see sort of a widow's peak up front that's very obscure. You see some fingers coming out on the left and the right. This is what it looks like invisible. Let's take a look now at what it looks like in the infrared. Completely different. Eventually, the opaque areas start to become transparent. And as we approach the mid-infrared, they actually glow. So it looks completely different. Here's another situation now where we can use the infrared capacity for redshift for the four basic themes. Let's take a quick look. I'm going to start on the right. You have the Hubble Deep Field, and it's going to look back in time for those very distant galaxies that are particular interest for James Webb. But on the left, while we're getting there, I want to point out these two images. Hubble is on the top and James Webb is on the bottom. Notice that Webb can see the spiral structure more clearly here. And those distant galaxies that are in the background that are very redshifted are very much more visible with Webb than they are with Hubble. This is the advantage that Webb will bring to the table when we're trying to look at the early universe. Now on the right, we have come to a very distant patch of sky, and lots of circles are showing up on the screen. Those circles are actually areas of interest to us for very early galaxies. Notice how blotchy and how red they appear, just like little blobs. The early galaxies appear to be kind of blob-like, definitely red. We're going to be interested in how galaxies change from what they looked like then to these beautiful spiral structures that we get today. And that's a question, what we call evolution of galaxies. How have they gotten today's form? Look on the left, a beautiful spiral galaxy seen in infrared, ultraviolet, X-ray, visible light. The X-ray, probably the image was taken by the Chandra X-ray Observatory. Visible is probably Hubble. So as you can see, we have a grand design spiral there. But how did we get from the blobs to that? Well, it appears, as these simulations show, that when galaxies come together, they affect each other and they change each other's shape. In the early universe, it started with the Big Bang. The early universe was tightly packed together and expanded. So maybe those early galaxies interacted with each other and over time evolved to the current day. We'll know because Webb will be able to see the first galaxies all the way out into the modern times. Let's talk now about star formation. Aha, this is where we use the infrared ability to peer through dusty environments. On the right, we see the Orion Nebula. All star formation occurs basically in molecular clouds, which are very dusty, very obscured. You can see here some bright patches where new stars are forming. It'll look like a tadpole structure in a moment because ions are blowing past these new stars that are forming. There's one right there. But in the center of it, you start to see a little ring. Let's zoom in on that ring. What's happening there? This is a proplid. There is a little very dusty environment containing particles and very tiny pieces of elements and so forth, dust that will aggregate together, gather momentum, collide, and eventually, we hope, form planets, probably how our own planet got formed. Webb should allow us to be able to peer into these very interesting environments because what we learn about other planets tells us a lot about what might have happened from our own experience. So let's talk a bit about exoplanets.
How do we learn about a planet's atmosphere? How do we know what's in the atmosphere of an exoplanet? The majority of known exoplanets have been discovered because they partially block the light of their host star. This is called a transit. During a transit, some of the star's light travels through the planet's atmosphere and gets absorbed. The light that survives carries information about the planet across light years of space where it reaches our telescopes. However, the planet is very small relative to the star, so it is still very difficult to detect, which is why we need a big telescope to be sure to capture this tiny bit of light. So how do we use a telescope to read transit light? Stars emit light at many wavelengths. Like a prism makes a rainbow, we can separate light into its separate wavelengths. This is called a spectrum. Visible light appears to our eyes as the colors of the rainbow, but beyond visible light, there are many wavelengths we cannot see. Now back to the transiting planet. As light is traveling through the planet's atmosphere, some wavelengths get absorbed. Which wavelengths get absorbed depends on which molecules are in the planet's atmosphere. For example, carbon monoxide molecules will capture different wavelengths than water vapor molecules. So when we look at that planet in front of the star, some of the wavelengths of the starlight will be missing, depending on which molecules are in the atmosphere of the planet. Learning about the atmospheres of other worlds is how we identify those that could potentially support life, bringing us another step closer to answering one of humanity's oldest questions. Are we alone?
Definitely one of the big questions. So where do we go next? Let's talk a little bit about planets around other stars or exoplanets. If we are interested in finding, let's say, a planet that actually houses light, how would we look for it? What would we look for? Well, on the left, I would like to show you a spectrum of the Earth's, of the sun's light coming through the Earth. This spectrum actually has absorption features that tell us what's in the atmosphere. For example, on the right, you see a cow here. Cows are responsible for methane, and methane is definitely detected in our atmosphere. Volcanoes have carbon dioxide signatures. Water vapor suggests perhaps habitability. Where there's water, often there's light. Oxygen and ozone. Vegetation jumps, that's interesting. And the sky, the blue of the sky. So if I could look for biosignatures in the light coming through an exoplanet, I would look for methane and water and oxygen and maybe the right combinations and the right ratios if I were interested in looking for life. That would be an interesting problem that might address, is there life on another planet? And that's an approach that actually we expect to be able to take soon. But it's a hard problem. Here's an example. Here's a star. How in the world do you detect a planet around a star? There are three planets around that star. But if I don't put something in to block the light, I can't even see them. The thing that we put in is a coronagraph, and James Webb will have a coronagraph. So how hard is this problem? Here's a picture of a relative size of the Earth in the upper left and the sun. It's a speck. It's really hard to tell. The picture on the right definitely has planets in it. Isn't it obvious to you? For an exoplanet, we're going to have a problem. Those are the three planets, the three exoplanets around that particular star. Obvious, right? Add a coronagraph, bingo. Now you can see them. All right. So it's considered a very challenging problem. And something that has been an analog is trying to detect a firefly in San Francisco next to some, you know, huge lighthouse. So James Webb is a complicated machine. It took years of development of one technology advancement after another to make it possible. This is a list of some of the examples of the technology that had to be taken on. And each of these technology developments does have associated with it in many ways, spin-offs that can benefit society in other ways. For example, we are going to take 18 hexagonal mirror segments and focus that mirror coherently after we launch it. So we actually have to be able to know how to focus things. We have to be able to understand phase differences. That helps with medical information. It helps to inform how we might do similar things on Earth. On the right is an example of testing mirrors. Remember, we're putting these mirrors a million miles away, frankly, just 40 degrees above absolute zero, the temperature at which things, all atoms stop moving. So how are we going to do that? Well, you have to test these things at a very cold temperature to make sure they're going to work. And lo and behold, if you take a mirror segment, you polish it, and it's good to go. What we actually did was bring it down to Marshall Space Flight Center in Alabama, chill it down, and then measure it and take a look. And you know what it did? It turned into a potato chip, distorted. So what we did was we made what is called a hit map. We figured out what parts need to be taken off and shimmed down and polished down in order to make it right. Took it out, polished those areas down, took it back, now it's flat. And so that we had to develop technologies to be able to do this, techniques to do it. There was a lot that needed to go on and has a lot of advantages in other areas, including national security, for example. So James Webb is complex. Here are the four instruments in the upper left that I talked about. We talked about high contrast imaging or coronagraphy, as you see there. We're also able to track the outer planets, those that are farther away, for example, than Mars. And so we can follow them as they move in their orbit. Spectroscopy is a big, big attribute of James Webb, the ability to separate the light into its component colors and figure out what elements they came from. But the sky is complex. For example, in this central section, you can see many, many different targets in the field. And the way we examine them is by opening up little shutters with near spec to let just individual targets through for spectroscopy. There is also something called integral field units in the upper right. We'll be able to look at planets with that technique, and we'll be able to do an awful lot. Sorry, I'm covering some of my images here, so I can't see them all. I just want to give you an example very briefly. Integral field unit is something that is relatively new for NASA missions in astrophysics. What it does is it takes an image of an object, but takes little slices of the object and puts each slice of that image through a spectrograph so that it can assess and analyze all the colors and all the wavelengths that are in that slice. And then they can stitch together the image afterwards, reconstruct it into what we call a data cube. And now you not only have the image, you also know the spectrum and what it's gonna look like at each particular color. On the upper right, we actually have the shutters that I was talking about for near spec. They are configurable by the user. There's an example of light shining through the shutter showing JWST. I am very confident, of course, that there will be a heart in my initials illustrated once they launch, but I haven't seen that yet. These are some pictures in the development that are past now. Here's the mirror opened up with the secondary above it. To the left, you see the instruments. The upper left, you see the entire science instrument module backplane. The upper right is one of my favorites. This is the test chamber at Johnson Space Flight Center in Texas. And the reason we were testing in this chamber, it was the only NASA chamber large enough to accommodate the James Webb mirror. This was the chamber used to test Apollo. I want you to notice how everybody is wearing what we call bunny suits in these pictures. Hair is covered, body is covered, masks. They do not want to contaminate this exquisite mirror. Now take a look. Here's the sunshield with somebody standing up, the NASA administrator, Charlie Bolden, with his arms out. And the only thing I can see is that I don't think his hair is covered. Now let's take a look. We're almost there. We're only a month away from the launch. I just want to give you an idea of what have been the steps leading up to it and what's ahead of us now. You're packing it up here and going to put it in a container for safe transport on a ship to French Guiana. This is very similar to residential motorcades that I've seen. All right, this is on its way from Northrop Grumman to the ship. And actually it spent 16 days by boat through the Panama Canal, as you see, traveling nearly 6,000 miles to get to Kourou. And it arrived on October 12th, just one short month ago. So we're getting there, folks. We don't have long to go. What are the last few steps and what can we expect ahead of us? Well, you already know that once it is released from the Ariane, it will begin deployment. On the left here, you see the many steps that you saw in that movement, in that movie. The solar ray starts only 31 minutes after it's released. Then the antenna, one day. Mid-course correction, that's correcting the orbit. Sunshield panel, and so on. Basically starting half an hour in, completing all the deployments almost a month later. In the entire time, the launch, ascent, final orbit, and all the deployments take about 30 days. And then the next stage begins. And this is approximately the time it's going to take us to get all the way to L2. The next stage that begins might be considered really the longest, and it has to do with letting the observatory come to its final temperature to equilibrate. And so that takes a long time. The optics have to come to thermal to their proper thermal environment. They need to be focused during this period of time. I've labeled that the optics in green. Some of the instruments need to get cold to operate properly. MIRI is one, and it doesn't come to its operating temperature until 96 days in. At 118 days, we're done with this component, and now we start bringing the instruments online. Slowly, we call this entire period commissioning. As we commission each of the instruments, they will become capable of taking images and spectroscopy and doing it in a calibrated fashion so that at the end of 6 months, 180 days, that's when we will roll out our first actual images from the observatory. And that's when I think we will see some really exciting stuff. So I'm wondering, how do we focus? 18 seconds in space at 40 degrees above absolute zero. Are we nuts? Notice all the little point sources of light from each mirror are all messed up and scattered. Slowly we overlap them into make one point focus. And that's what happens. In space, we will be doing it in real time from, of all things, commanded from Baltimore, from my institution. Space Telescope sends commands to Webb and receives back the data. And that's done through the Deep Space Network, which I won't discuss much here, but I'm happy to do so. Basically, the Deep Space Network has three ground stations in Canberra, Australia, Madrid, Spain, and Goldstone, California. And as the data, as the Earth rotates, the data can come down to any of those three ground stations and will be sent to Baltimore. Commands will be sent and eventually loaded back up to the observatory. This is a picture of the science operation and the mission operations center where the commands will be sent in Baltimore. I have been inside, but I'm hoping to be seeing it next month. But I would like to mention that in fact, there's much more involved than just commanding. Commanding is only a component of it. It's what the flight what's labeled here as flight operations. But in fact, space telescope also will provide science operations. We will host peer review panels for individual scientists to propose to observe with James Webb. Anybody in the world is allowed to propose to observe. It'll have to be a good proposal to be accepted, but anybody can, including you and me. If your proposal is selected, you will probably be granted money in order to do your observation. We will then plan and schedule your observation, send the commands to the observatory, orient the observatory, take the data, bring the data down, pipeline process it so it's readable and usable and calibrated, put it in the archive, disseminate it to you so you can analyze it and so that you can publish it, and eventually so that it can go into classrooms and to newspapers and be enjoyed by the rest of the world. All right, we now know what the first cycle of observation will show us, because people have proposed for the first cycles. There is some discretionary time that's been dedicated, and we now know approximately what we can expect, and it's actually quite thrilling. 10,000 hours have been set aside of observing. That will include approximately 6,000 hours of general observer time, which is what you would have if you proposed and won. There are 400 individual programs and 11,000 proposals were submitted, more than 2,500 worldwide investigations, and each year we expect to have a new call for proposals. Nearly every area of astrophysics and planetary astronomy is represented in the first cycle, and I was very excited to see what's done here. Remember how we're going to talk about how galaxies assemble. We now know that these galaxies here will be studied. They have been successfully selected for observation. So I'm actually thrilled about some of the observations I saw here. I am familiar with great observatories and what they consider their top 10 achievements. What I see in front of me in the next few slides already promise to have that kind of return. So I think it will be a history-making observatory. Local galaxies here that are going to be observed, spectacular. And here's, I will, without commenting, some science comments about what also will be returned. This is the center of our own galaxy. Very crowded environment, perfect view for James Webb. What you may or may not know is that in our own galaxy and in many galaxies, most actually, there is a black hole in the center called Sagittarius A star. It's there right where that it says galactic center, right where the galactic center is. So this is going to be a very complex and interesting region to examine. And by the way, it's worth mentioning that I think it was last year, the Nobel Prize was granted for the discovery of the black hole and they established that there was a black hole at the center of our galaxy. James Webb will be looking at the solar system at our exciting planets, as you see, not only Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, but also the many moons. And these are the instruments that will be used to examine the moons. And what kinds of things will we be seeing besides images? Well, this I found very interesting because I'm not a planetary astronomer. What I did not know is we would be looking at the red spot. We would be looking for new small moons that have not yet been discovered. We would be looking at Saturn's rings. There appear to be oceans below the surface of the moons Europa and Enceladus. And you know what they say, an ocean, if there's water, there might be life. So it's thrilling. There are volcanoes on Io, right? There's a hydrocarbon atmosphere on Titan. We're going to be looking for new chemical species and looking at the seasons. Kind of an amazing plan ahead. So I mentioned space telescope will be responsible for science operations, but you may know that Hubble is pretty much a brand name in so many ways and has made it into the popular culture, and it's the People's Telescope. It's really important that James Webb also become the People's Telescope. So I'm going to give you some examples of Hubble here. There's what is called a guitar skin. There's a Hubble skinned guitar. In the center is a human skin with a Hubble image. It's actually a tattoo. And on the right, you see tights and a dress that are inspired by Hubble images. So what will happen? Will James Webb be equally loved? Let's take a look. There's already art. Here's emerging from the mirrors. Here's an example of jewelry. I'm very fond of jewelry, inspired by James Webb. Here's a, looks like a watercolor screen with James Webb. And most recently, this last Halloween, already people are carving pumpkins. So the signs are good that we may be there. And that's all I have to say for now. I did want to thank again, George Burnell, in memory. I wanted to thank Matthew for running this and Helen also for inviting me. Eric Smith from NASA headquarters, individuals from Space Telescope and now at Ball, the Office of Public Outreach. And I would like to say that almost nothing I did that was eye candy was actually done by me. It was probably done by NASA, ESA, and Space Telescope, and I stole it. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathryn. That was absolutely fascinating. If you have questions, please send them via the Q&A button or simply raise your hand and I can give you permission to talk.
Should I stop sharing or do you want me to stay on?
Yeah, if you want to.
Okay.
Yeah, we can always restart if people are referring to a specific thing. One question has come in so far. How long did the Big Bang last?
Ooh, the Bang itself, I think, was very fast. I mean, fast is a relative term, but I think it was fast. However, we're not going to go and see the Big Bang. We're going to see maybe 100 million years afterwards when the galaxies formed. That far we know we can get to. And that's what the design of the observatory was. But if you actually, I'm not an expert in cosmology, I'm not an expert in this field, but there is a book that I read when I was a kid called The First 3 Minutes, which kind of tells you a lot happens within 3 minutes, right? So I'm going to say that the Big Bang occurred very quickly, the initial expansion.
We have some more questions coming in. So one person asked, the Hubble has required periodic servicing. What's new on the Webb telescope that does not require human visits?
Well, Webb is going to be 3 times farther away than the moon. So it's not going to be by any normal means serviceable by an astronaut. It's too far away. It's too dangerous to get out there. All of the servicing that has occurred in a low Earth orbit, which would be between the moon and the Earth. And in fact, maybe 600 miles above the Earth kind of a thing. So James Webb at this juncture simply is not serviceable. It's not uncommon at all. Most astrophysics observatories are not serviceable or not serviced. Some may be serviceable and future ones may be serviceable. There are many concepts being bandied about where servicing could be considered. But at the moment, I don't anticipate that it will be. That's the bad news. The good news is that with very good course correction, we may have enough fuel to keep Webb operating for longer than 10 years. 10 years is the goal. Could be 12, could even be longer if we're smart about how we do our observing. So I encourage you all to keep your fingers crossed during all of those critical deployments, because when I first read about them, I was going, oh, really? Really? But it's going to be great. It's going to be fun.
I'd like to thank for how long the Voyager spacecraft survived. And that was back in the 70s, that probably pretty good at doing it now.
Yeah, well, I mean, the Chandra X-ray Observatory went up in, I think, 99. So it's more than 20 years on. Hubble is well past 30, which for observatories, I mean, that's young, but for observatories, that's not the design lifetime, right? So I have to give credit to all of these groups. They've been very careful to make sure, and to the best of their ability, everything works, because what we're doing here is, you know, it's a one-off.
Do you, I think you said it already, but someone asked again, if you want to just restate, how far will the telescope be traveling from the Earth?
About 1 million miles, approximately, right? It needs to get out. That's the magic location where it will be balanced by the gravitational force of the Earth and the sun, and therefore guarantee that it'll stay in a line so that the sunshield can keep it in the shadow. And so, but 1 million miles is so far out there. I mean, it's just so far out there. And it's the cold of space, not just far. It's a very tricky environment. So yes, it's approximately that distance. It's called L2 if you want to look at that.
Let's see. Two people asked, why does it need to be launched from French Guiana?
So I should do a little more research, but I think there are two major reasons. For one, French Guiana is the launch center that is operated by ESA, and this is an ESA launch vehicle. And so that's appropriate. But the second one is it's near the equator, and you understand that the Earth rotates. And if you have something right at the equator, it gives it that additional boost, right? So I suspect that is probably one of the reasons why French Guiana is the optimum choice.
What did the telescope cost NASA?
So I know, I'm guessing, I don't know the final number, but I'm guessing to develop the hardware was $9 billion. I do know it was $8 billion until it had a very recent delay in its launch, estimated launch date. I think for a long time they kept it still within reserves, but it may have gone beyond $8 billion. So I'm guessing about $9 billion, but I don't know. The operations will be funded, I think, pretty robustly going forward, and depending on how long James Webb is operated, that would be an additional expense. Of course, all the payoff comes after it's off the launch pad and once it's taking the data. So that is certainly money well spent. I will say, it's probably worth saying that I've been thinking about this recently, and although there was a lot of criticism, I give Congress an awful lot of credit for signing the checks and holding a hard line and enabling this to go forward, because NASA science has had support, both parties, House and Senate, doesn't matter. And they, on behalf of the American people, they've done a really wonderful thing here. And I was recalling today, on the back of the House Science Committee meeting room is a sign that says, without vision, the people perish. And I think this is an example of maybe following through on that. Fingers crossed, I hope so.
So too. Do you have time to take a couple more questions?
Sure, happy to.
Someone had asked, what was the connection to medical research you mentioned?
That I don't know much about the particulars there, but because we have done so much phasing of an optic, we had to have an optic with 18 segments, and each segment had seven degrees of freedom, right? Motion in all three dimensions, and rotations, and a little bit of curvature added, and all of this taken together, they had to develop techniques for how to optimally focus such a complex system. And the presumption is that those techniques, which are, phasing the mirrors, those techniques might have application with optical medical techniques.
Are there examples from Hubble? You might have said them, but that kind of happened
for
other telescopes?
Oh, to be honest with you, I can tell you, I believe that all of these facilities have had amazing technological spinoffs. I know an individual who developed something, and it's in most of your, you know, most of your iPhones now, right?
That's incredible.
I mean, when you think about it, almost all of what NASA does in its science has to push forward, has to make a great advance in order to do it. And it's the risk of failing, the risk of going down the wrong path is high, but it's worth it, right? And so we do it. But once you do that, what follows from that almost always has immense capability. Even truthfully, a lot of what NASA does, in my opinion, even the inspiration from NASA, many engineers at, for example, Northrop Grumman say that they actually were attracted into engineering by what NASA science does or what NASA does. So the impact is not only on the technology, the impact is also in the STEM fields, what we call STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. It has an impact on defense, has an impact in many, many areas. But technology is just the most obvious.
Wow. There's another question. Again, you may have addressed this, but is the James Webb more accurate than Hubble, and can it detect more than just galaxies?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, yes to the second for sure. Detects much more than just galaxies. Remember, we're going to be looking at tiny little planets around distant stars, right? That's much, much smaller than a galaxy. A galaxy is, you know, big by comparison. So yes, we will see very fine details. And what's interesting, everybody, the whole world is familiar with the exquisite images of Hubble. What they may not realize is that James Webb is a different wavelength, but in the areas where it overlaps Hubble, it should do better imaging than Hubble in those same areas. So it is commensurate with that kind of exquisite seeing. There is one thing that I didn't mention and I should have. If you're interested in the search for life, is there life elsewhere in the universe? Which I think is one of the most interesting questions of, you know, of our century going forward. The astronomy and astrophysics community came together, as they do every 10 years, and prioritized their scientific interests, and they prioritized where they think the technology investments should go for future missions. And it looks like the first in the queue is something designed essentially to look at biosignatures of exoplanets and answer that question. And it will also enable us to look at small components of what make up galaxies, be able to do unbelievable astrophysics. So I was pretty excited to hear about this. I was waiting to find out what the choice would be. I knew it was going to be visionary no matter what was picked, but it looks like that might be the first in the queue. However, there are other visionary missions immediately queued up, ready to go with technology investment plans so that they can go. So I'm pretty excited. I think it's going to be great next few years.
I'm really excited too. When did you say we can expect to see first images from the telescope?
6 months after launch. So we're going to launch 7:30 a.m. December 18th, if everything goes as planned. Luckily, I got invited to the party, so I have to be there at 5:30. Why are all great babies born in the middle of the night? And 6 months later is when I expect the first spectroscopy and images to be released. What will happen is towards the end, as the instruments come online and they become more capable, the observatory will make some observations, analyze them, get them ready and queued up, and it'll be embargoed. And what I expect to have happen is a basic reveal right about that time. So December, so I guess that's June, right? Is that June or May?
Probably, yeah. May or June, yeah.
Okay, that's a good time.
That's a great time. Maybe around that time we can have you come back.
Happy to.
Love to review some of the cool new images that we'll be seeing. Thank you so much, Kathryn. This was amazing. And thank you everyone for attending tonight and for all of your questions. This program is recorded and will be on our YouTube channel later this week. And thank you again.
Thank you. You can share my email if you'd like with anybody if there are residual questions. I'm happy to talk.
Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah, I'll send that out. Great.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Have a good night.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Take care.